Welcome. My name is Elena Brower, and I am a presidential diamond with doTERRA. I am here for about the last 5 years, working my business for about 3 or 4 years. I am so proud of all the work that we all do, and if you are watching this, I am really happy to be here with you. I started teaching yoga when I was about 28 years old, so 20 years ago. And yoga for me has been a journey of healing, healing my mind, healing my body, healing my heart. And I'll share a little bit about that with you here today. What exactly is yoga? When you close your eyes and you take a nice big deep breath, and you can do that with me right now, you feel some sort of shift internally. What is that? That shift is a unification of your attention with your body, your breathing, and your mind. That unification is the definition of the word yoga, literally means union. And for me, yoga is both a practice and a state of awareness. So when all things come together, when you take that deep breath and suddenly everything from the outside world is turned inside and your attention is within, inward. And everything you feel about the outside world is suddenly turned off for a moment. That unification is and can be your practice. Yoga, as we practice it today, has movements and postures. It incorporates meditation. But really, yoga is just that one deep breath where you unify with yourself, all the parts of yourself. It's been practiced for thousands of years, and it was originally created or thought up to help people meditate, seated meditation, for longer periods of time comfortably with a healthy body. So, that said, when we bring the body and the nervous system and the mind together to that unity, we release stress, we heal old trauma. And we harness our capacity to choose wisely in our daily interactions. Choosing wisely in our daily interactions literally means, can I be kind? Can I be graceful? Can I host compassion for someone who is troubling to me? These are all really important practices for humanity at this time, especially. We move the body in conscious ways. We breathe in certain patterns, for example, just to balance your inhalation and your exhalation, to make the length of each even, is to quiet the nervous system and to bring the body back towards the healing state that it is constantly trying to return to. The healing state that we have during sleep. When we begin to balance our breathing, not scared, not super happy, not gasping. But when we balance our breathing, we find ourselves very calmed in a different state entirely. So we concentrate also the mind in very specific ways in yoga practice. These practices of moving, breathing, and ways to concentrate the mind, very simple ways, are how we bring the body, the nervous system, and the mind, thinking mind, together. Into this coherent, cohesive, cooperative state is also known as yoga. So it's not just the practices, it's also the state. Now, that state repeated over time, when we consistently practice, we consistently take a deep breath instead of reacting. Repeated over time, that state becomes what is called a trait. And in my experience personally, I found that at first it wasn't natural for me. I was in a state of fear all the time. I couldn't really see who I was. I couldn't see my potential. I couldn't understand how I could be successful, and not just in the sort of obvious meaning of the word successful, but successful as a person, kind and compassionate, hopeful even. These repeated practices. Repeating the state of yoga as it becomes a trait, that becomes your new neutral, your new norm. So, why do I do this? Why do I teach for the last 20 years? I teach because of my own tendencies to overdo or underdo or not do, to run away from things. I teach because I saw how the practices became states and how the states became trait. And now the trait that I host in my body, most of the time, if I remember, is a state of unification, of union, of yoga. And that state for me is now my new norm. And sure, I deviate. Sure, I get angry. Sure, I get happy. Sure, I get frustrated. All those things happen, of course. I'm human. But more and more, I feel that trait alive within me. What's most interesting is that it wasn't so easy until I found essential oils. And they actually found me about 20 years ago when I was practicing yoga. I was actually in my own yoga studio that I owned for some time. And I realized that there was something to the oils that I didn't really understand, but I knew needed to be a part of my life. And it wasn't till just about 10 years ago when someone introduced me to doTERRA that I began playing with doTERRA oils. And it was 5 years ago that I finally said yes, five and a half now. I finally said yes. And when I realized how perfectly synergistic the essential oils are with the yoga practice, I began to actively use the oils when I practice, before, during, and after I practice. And what I found is the oils actually amplify the practice, the state, and ultimately the trait that yoga seems to be. So, if the yoga is developing a type of mind that sort of reflects keen, awake awareness, and therefore is the type of mind that is steady and open and at ease, the moments spent in that state accrue and they become a trait. What do the oils do to amplify that trait? In my own experience, what I found is that the processes that are undergone in my body during yoga are actually magnified, as I said, amplified by the presence of the oils. We know that essential oils influence the mood and the emotions. We know how direct the connection is between the nasal passages and the instinctive or limbic brain. We know that essential oils provide essential new energetic imprints or patterns in our thinking. We know that if we're feeling a state of lack or a state of I failed, and we smell a citrus oil, especially orange, we know that that's going to change our state, even just momentarily for a glimpse. We also know that the oils helped us shift and refine the quality of our responses, not just externally, but also within ourselves. So, teaching yoga for the past 2 decades and watching how, when I add an essential oil into a posture with my own body, just grab one, even just smelling it, I don't even necessarily have to apply it. I began to make the correlation that the oils, in fact, are vital in the practices of yoga. And I don't practice without my oils now. When I'm teaching, for those of you who are watching who might be a teacher, what I'd love you to do is just bring your oils with you to class for the first few months of you integrating the oils into your teaching setting and just have them at the front as an option. You don't need to pass them around right away unless specifically in oils in yoga class. But what I did for many months was I just had my little carry bag, my beautiful little bag at the front of the classroom, and I would say to people after the class, "Hey guys, if you would like to anoint yourself before you go, please feel free. These are my own personal oils. This is my personal collection, and you're more than welcome to rifle through it and get into it." People did. Many of my earliest enrollments came from those beautiful moments of connection post yoga, where people were just introducing themselves to my collection. And I didn't have to force it on the class either, which is a really nice consideration because a lot of times the oils are brought into classes where people don't expect the oils, and it's important for them to have the freedom to choose. So that's a little caveat from my experience. Now, we know that the oils and the practice both help us to design our moods. We've seen that happen time and time again, where, as I said, we don't feel well. We smell an oil, something gently shifts. We diffuse a certain blend, something gently shifts. And so we want to create new energetic imprints. We want to create moments where we are in charge of how our emotional state rolls out from us into the world. And if we use both the oils and the practice, we have a really good chance of refining things for ourselves. So, the funniest aspect of all of this, I think, and worth mentioning, is that I was teaching yoga to be helpful, to help people learn how to design their moods and learn how to refine their responses and really dissolve their reactivity. The funniest thing is that it's ultimately the essential oils that helped me do that. It wasn't the yoga alone. And now I can reach many more people as you can, because you have the oils on your side and you really can leave them to their own devices. The oils speak for themselves. And today we'll talk about three very special blends. So I use in my own practice a combination of the following. I always use the emotional aromatherapy touch kit. I love it, console, peace, motivate, and cheer. I also use jasmine on my heart. I use rose on my wrists and inner elbows. Smell it right now on the back of my neck, usually. I use neroli and magnolia on my forearms, not together, but I alternate those guys, those girls. And the one that I use the most, though, the collection that I use the most during my practice is definitely the yoga collection. I love them all. We have anchor, align, and arise. And the combination of the three really helps me to soften and receive and slow down. And I thought I would talk just a little bit about how I teach the yoga collection, because I don't do what you might expect me to do. Of course, at the start of a practice, anchor is offering a grounding sensation. We know that it contains lavender and cedarwood and frankincense, cinnamon bark, sandalwood, black pepper, patchouli, and a base of fractionated coconut oil already diluted. So I use anchor on the tops of my feet, not necessarily the bottoms. Pardon. And I also use anchor on my wrists. The base of my spine, my lower back. That's a really nice one. I usually start my practice lying down and doing some deep breathing. That wasn't always the case. When I was younger, I started my practice standing and sun salutes and all the active things. Now it is my great pleasure and luxury and need to start lying down. Anchor is the perfect foil for a busy day. Considerations and contemplations. I like to take a moment to consider who, in that moment of my use of the oil, who is serving as an anchor in my life? Who is serving as an anchor in your life? And who helps you locate and stay in your steady foundation? These are really nice questions to ask when you use anchor if you've got your oil out now. And can you hold gratitude for anyone who serves as an anchor to you with their presence in your life? And that we call our steadying blend. When it comes to a more active state of practice, align is what's called for. And a line, of course, has bergamot, coriander, marjoram, so beautiful for active body, peppermint, geranium, basil, rose, jasmine. It's such a brightening, enlightening, gorgeous big scent align. So I use it very sparingly, but I love it so much. And I like to apply it over my heart, to my wrists, and to the back of my neck. Beautiful. When you're in the sunshine, please take care to avoid application on any part of your body that will be in the sun because it does have photosensitive oils in it. For your considerations and contemplations, and I like to apply this sometime in the middle of the practice when I notice myself kind of shying away from something difficult, whether it's a complicated posture or just breath work. Because sometimes it's more fun to distract myself than it is to dive in and do the work of getting to know myself. Align is perfect for that. Considerations and contemplations. Take a moment to help you consider who helps you stay in alignment in your life. Who helps you stay on course? Who helps you stay on purpose, centered in your heart space? And can you hold gratitude for the inspiration to hold that center steady and clear? And that gratitude can be for someone who helps you, or it can be for yourself. The third blend in the yoga collection is called Arise. And this one is considered the enlightening blend, as bright and lovely as Align is. Oh, this is so wonderful. The components: lemon, grapefruit, Siberian fir, osmanthus, and melissa. Beloved, this blend, especially by, I find, men coming to me and saying, "Wow, Arise is so gorgeous. Thank you for that." Temples, wrists, pulse points, back of neck. Again, please avoid any sun exposure after application. And if you know you'll be in the sun, perhaps do it in a part of your body that doesn't get the sun exposure, maybe underneath your arm. Arise, I like during meditation. A lot of people love Arise during the most active part of the practice toward the end, sort of around if you have an apex pose. I love it during meditation. I love to place it right here if I know I'm not going to be in the sun, right on my third eye, and just sit. The tiniest hint of a smell of this blend is so invigorating, but in such a calm way. The addition of the Siberian fir and the melissa really took this blend to a very cool dimension. Considerations and contemplations, finally. Pardon. Take a moment to consider who lights you up. Help yourself remember who has inspired you and lifted you. And who helps you uphold that highest? So many times we are doing really well and flying right along, and then somehow we get taken down, and it's hard to stay up that high. And we have people around us who help us remember. So take a moment to hold gratitude in your heart for those folks, the people who help you remember your highest, who help you remember your light and your courage and your vision. Finally, how do we get started with yoga? Let's say you have never done yoga in your life. You have a few different ways to begin. So the first is to remember that yoga can really be as simple as one full breath and unify your attention with your body, your nervous system, your mind. Begin to calm whatever state is going through you just using your breath. That too is yoga. You can go to local classes. Most towns the world over now have some sort of yoga offering. But if for some reason yours does not, or you prefer not to be in public when you learn, you have two other options. You may hire a private instructor. That person might be a little bit costly the first two or three times, but you'll get the basics, and then you can enter into a class feeling like you know what you're doing, roughly. You can also get online, and there are some really beautiful services online that you can try. The one with which I'm most familiar and the one that I use is called glow.com, GLO. Wonderful teachers, wonderful quality, and really nice classes. Smart and safe. So if you are going to a local class, just keep one thing in mind. You should leave that room feeling more connected to yourself, feeling more a unified whole than you did when you walked in. And if you don't, if you walk out of that room and you don't feel unified and you don't feel connected and you feel somehow in any way diminished, don't think anything of it. Just go try another teacher. I say this because not because there are teachers who are talented and teachers who aren't. Everyone is trying their best, to be fair. But you will resonate with a certain teacher where you might not with another. And it's important to give yourself a few chances to see what style, what kind of voice, what kind of languaging really works for you to move you, literally and figuratively. So I thank you for joining me on this summit today. It's such a pleasure and a privilege, really, to present the yoga collection and yoga at large to you. And I thank you so much for having me.
My name is Dawna Toews from Raw Mama, and I am honored to talk about this really important topic that has truly changed my life. What we're going to talk about today is just why I think, unbeknownst to doTERRA, why they chose me to do this topic. And mostly it's because I never used to meditate whatsoever. And so if that's you, you are in the right spot today. I'm also going to talk about what meditation is, what it isn't, who needs meditation, and why I believe essential oils are vitally important to this practice, and what it has done to change my practice in meditation. And finally, I'm going to take you through a guided meditation in the end. So first, who am I and why am I talking about this? Well, if you had asked any of my friends, they would be probably wondering the same thing. Before I began my meditation practice that I currently have, I was not even actually for meditation. And I really, truly thought that it just was not good for me. In fact, I became anxious just thinking about it. And I know many of you out there may be feeling the same way. I'm like, Donna, I try to do this meditation thing, but I end up just feeling worse about myself and that I can't do it right. And, you know, that it just, I want to get up and walk away. And that for sure was me. And then I tried going to a group meditation thinking that's going to help me. And what it ended up doing was making me just want to run away because I'm seeing all of these people seemingly do this effortlessly. And I'm looking around the room going, okay, but my thoughts, they're just going crazy and I can't stop them. And so what ended up happening for me was a beautiful woman who recommended 3x3. And now this intrigued me because I didn't understand 3x3. I thought meditation was something that you have to sit down in this, you know, straight backed posture, and you have to sit there for an hour and let the mystics and the universe come and do whatever it's supposed to do. And so 3x3, I thought, well, this is interesting. What it ended up being was 3 minutes, 3 times a day. And I thought, well, maybe I can do that. And what it does is it helps you throughout your day. You start 3 minutes in the morning, 3 minutes in the afternoon, 3 minutes in the evening. And that made sense to me because we wouldn't think, well, I'm going to eat once in the morning and then I don't have to eat throughout the day. Well, it's the same thing with our emotions. If you feel, you know, anxious in the morning, that doesn't mean you're going to feel great at the end of the day. And in the same way, if you feel great in the morning, it doesn't mean you're going to feel great at the end of the day. So this is, to me, it was a beautiful practice. But my wheels were still turning and I still couldn't get them to stop. And I thought, well, this can't be what meditation is. And finally, what ended up helping me was these doTERRA essential oils. And I'm going to talk about which ones helped me, but they've really changed my life because what it does is it helps me just stop the monkey mind from turning, turning, turning. But what we'll talk about today is that the mind is doing what it's supposed to do. And what I learned through my meditations is that we don't want to stop the mind. What we're doing is we're just redirecting it. And as I began my meditation, what I recognized was that it wasn't that my mind was spinning just because I was trying to meditate. It was that as I slowed my day, as I became quiet, I realized how much my thoughts in my mind were really in control, you know, and it's only when I slowed down that I recognized this. And so the more I meditated and the more I just shifted my meditation, shifted my thoughts, I mean, it became really a meditation practice as opposed to a meditation perfect, because that's not what we're trying to go for in our meditation. And so let's talk about what meditation is a little bit more and what it isn't. The intention of meditation doesn't come from one person. It's not created by one individual, one mystic or one guru or one religion. I believe that meditation is for human beings. And a lot of the time we are human doings, and what meditation can help us do is just be. It can help us just pause. It can help us allow for the emotions that we have, who we truly are, and help us restore back to that perfection that we really are inside. And the thoughts that we have on an everyday basis, most of them are not even our own. And it is said that most of the thoughts, tens of thousands even sometimes, are negative, and we just repeat them over and over and over in our day. So can you imagine the beautiful moments in our day where we can just try to move those thoughts into focus, and that it's just a practice. You know, when I do my meditation, I don't fault my mind for racing. I allow it. And I just say, thank you. Thank you, mind. That's what you're supposed to do. And now I'm just going to move over here. And then my mind will race again. Thank you. Yeah, you're doing what you're supposed to do. You're doing what you're designed to do. And now I'm just going to move over here. And it took away a lot of that anxiety inside of me where I'm like, I'm still thinking. Oh my gosh, how do I stop thinking? But I promise you that every time you say thank you and you move towards this place of pause, and you just, every time you refocus, it is one step closer to a meditation practice for you that will take you through your days in a way that you move not from your day to meditation, but you move your meditation into your day. And that to me is really my goal. It's to move meditation from sitting alone in the quiet of my home in the mornings is when I do it. And I take that moment, I take that pause, I take that restoration, and I move it throughout the rest of my day. And I feel it. I feel that everywhere I go. And I don't want us to say, you know, I'm not going to walk because I don't want to be a speed walker, or I'm not going to ever work out because I don't want to be an Olympian or a gymnast. You know, we wouldn't say that. And so in the same way, don't think of meditation as, well, I don't want to be a mystic. I don't want to be a guru. I don't want to be somebody who practices this thing as a purpose in their life. So therefore, I'm not going to practice any meditation. We can just do this a little bit each day, or we can do this a lot. It's up to you. There's no right, and there certainly is no wrong way to do meditation. So that is what meditation, and again, who needs meditation? Well, all of us. And what meditation helps us do, it helps us just to breathe slower. It helps us to breathe deeper. And one thing that that I was just thinking about and came across was, you know, when we think of how many breaths per minute different species on the earth, you know, have, and dogs, they have about 24 at a resting and 35 at the most. And dogs live about 15, 16, you know, depending on the dog. And if you look at humans, we breathe about 16 times a minute. And we live about, on average, give or take, right, depending on gender and all the different variables, but we live about 72 years. If you look at elephants, they breathe about 10 to 12 times a minute. They live about 86 years on average. And then you look at the turtle, and the turtle breathes about 4 times per minute, and it lives up to upwards of 200 years. And so you can see how important breathing is to us. And most of us are walking around taking very shallow, short breaths. And it's happened. We take lots of different breaths. And what meditation can help us do is just to bring our breathing deeper. And deep breathing can help with those, you know, endorphin emotions, you know, those feel-good hormones. It can help with it as a natural painkiller, promotes better blood flow. So this is like energy. We're talking about all of these things, and it helps us also to be youthful. So meditation is not just because you're stressed, even though there's a lot of people walking around stressed, and this can really help with that in your everyday life. Now, which type of oils can help with that? Well, there is no right or wrong oil. And if I had a PowerPoint presentation, I would have a list of all of the different oils that people have used for their meditation practice. But today we're going to focus on about three of them. And these are three of my favorite. And the first one is the king of all oils, and it's frankincense. Now, frankincense, it really promotes grounding. It promotes overall well-being and relaxation. And so you can understand with that, those properties, it would be perfect for your meditation practice. The second one is sandalwood. This one is really my all-time favorite oil for meditation, because what I love about sandalwood, and something that I just learned when I went on a sourcing trip with doTERRA, is that the oil from sandalwood that is extracted, the best oil happens when it goes to the injury of a tree, and all of the oil pools to this one area of the tree. And this is the part of the oils that the part of the tree that we are extracting. And symbolically, as you are in your meditation practice, this can be used in tandem, in partnership with your body. You don't even have to think about it. But what it's doing is the body is utilizing this tool. It's utilizing this oil to come into your body to do what the body needs to support itself. It's a beautiful symbolic awakening for us to know how powerful these oils are with meditation. And finally, the third oil that I want to talk about today is Melissa. And now Melissa, the chemical constituents within this oil are powerful for relaxation, and it has soothing properties. And you can understand how if you can have chemical constituents within a bottle like Melissa to promote well-being, to promote, to decrease the stress in our lives, why this would be amazing for your meditation practice. And so I'm going to talk about that when we get to our guided meditation. But we want to use this aromatically or we want to use this topically. So you can use this both ways. And what I do is I will take just a drop in my hand and I will breathe that in. So before we move any further, I want everyone, I would like to just invite you to a guided relaxation. And so first I'm going to teach everyone a little bit how to breathe because again, a lot of us, we're not really breathing properly. And so I want everyone to just close your eyes and put your hand right on your belly. And when you breathe in, I want you to breathe in through your nose. And when you breathe in, your belly should actually come out. And a lot of us, when we breathe, our shoulders rise. But this time I want you to breathe through your nose deeply. And when you breathe in, your belly should come out. And when you breathe out, your belly should come back in. And if you have a hard time with this, after this meditation practice, I want you to just go and lay down in your bed at night, put some books on your belly. And when you breathe in, the books will rise. And when you breathe out, the books will fall. So now I want you to take your favorite oil and I want you to put a drop in your hand. And I want you to breathe in like we just practiced, just gently in through your nose. And we're going to do this together three times. So take a deep breath in with me and a deep breath out. And one more deep breath in. And deep breath out. And actually one more deep breath in. And a deep breath out. Now I want you to put one hand back on your belly and one hand on your heart. And I want you to visualize with me as you're breathing in, breathe in the oxygen to your heart and just picture the oxygen filling up your heart. And as you breathe out, I want you to feel the expression of your heart moving towards your body. So we're just going to take a few breaths there. Breathe in, filling the oxygen into your heart. Breathe out, the expression of your heart towards your whole body. And again, breathe in. And breathe out. And one last time, breathing in and breathe out. And with your hands still in your heart and your eyes closed, and keep breathing as I'm talking, I want you to just feel, if you can feel your heartbeat, and just picture the heart and how beautiful it's been to you. And how it continues to beat without us even thinking about it. And it's moving through all of the body. And it has been protecting you all this time. It has been moving through your whole body all this time. And now when you take a deep breath in, I want you to breathe in love from your heart. And I want you to breathe out the expression of that love to wherever you need it in your body. Do you feel pain? Do you feel hurt? Maybe you feel loneliness today. Maybe you feel sad or angry. As you breathe into your heart and you breathe out, allow, along with the essential oils that you just breathed in, the expression of the partnering of your body together. And take a few deep breaths in and out again. And take one last deep breath in. Deep breath out and wiggle your fingers and your toes. And come back to the room. And my hope for you is that if you would love to come back and, you know, find this meditation and take this with you and take this journey with you and find a meditation that suits you, that works for you, because there's no right or wrong way to do this. And use these essential oils. They have helped me so much in my focus, in my feelings of just being grounded and present. And I hope that this has served you today. So thank you.
Hello, my friends. My name is Hayley Hobson. I'm a double presidential diamond with doTERRA, and I'm here to talk to you about Pilates today, the benefits of Pilates, and the essential oil protocol that you could use during your Pilates practice. So for those of you who don't know, I actually started my Pilates practice in the late 90s. It's been a long time. Is that aging me? And I became a Pilates instructor in 1999, 2000, I think I graduated. And I taught Pilates for about 15 years before I started my doTERRA practice. So I had my own studio and I managed multiple health clubs and their Pilates, their mind body department. And Pilates was really a passion of mine for a very long time. And it still is. And there's different kinds of Pilates, and I still actually practice Pilates on my own to this day. I think it's an unbelievable form of mind-body exercise. So for those of you who don't know, Pilates is the traditional, I should say the traditional Pilates method, because there's so many different spin-offs on Pilates now, but the traditional Pilates method is a system of movement and really therapeutic exercise developed over a span of about 60 years by a German-born athlete and a physical therapy pioneer whose name was Joseph H. Pilates. And he actually utilized the specialized equipment that he designed. And I say specialized because there is a very specific type of equipment that is used in what we call traditional Pilates. And he utilized this specialized equipment that he designed, by the way. And his method works by toning muscles as well as by balancing muscular force at the joint level. And the reason that's very different from other types of exercises is you're working with very small movement patterns, not a lot of weight. The machines are spring-based, and you're working at a joint level, like in your joints. So you're not lifting heavy things, you're strengthening the tissues and the joints. And what the benefits of Pilates, what it does is it stimulates circulation through facilitating this muscular flexibility, joint range of motion, and proper musculoskeletal alignment. And in addition, it promotes new neuromuscular patterns, a much more heightened body awareness, and much more precise coordination in the body. And all of these things together combine to help you, as the practitioner, prevent future injury or re-injury and reduce, even in some cases, or alleviate chronic pain altogether. So I know that was a lot of big words that I gave you, but in more layman's terms, really what it means is that when we are exercising and we're putting our body weight forward and we're doing movement, a lot of times we're coming from a place of what I call the global bigger muscular points in our body. So like our quads or our buttocks are the most widely used muscles in the body, right? And when we use those over and over and over again, we start to overdevelop certain muscles in the body, and other muscles might become underdeveloped. And a lot of this happens not only from just working out, but it happens even by sitting there in the chair that you're sitting in watching this video or in your bed. You may have patterns like sitting at your computer like this, right? Or laying on your side like this. And there's an overdevelopment or overutilization of certain muscular patterns that happen in the body, overusing some muscles, overstretching some muscles, and then as a consequence, underutilizing other muscles in the body. And what happens as a result of this is it messes up the alignment in your body. And as a result, you are weaker in certain areas and oftentimes have tightness or inflammation, which ultimately results in pain. So you may notice that when you sit at your desk for a really long time, or you're walking in a certain kind of shoe for a really long time, or you're sleeping in a bed that's not enhancing your alignment, or you're practicing a sport where you're over, like let's just think about baseball, the same movement over and over and over and over and over and over again. I think about my husband, who was a professional triathlete, and he sat on his bike, you know, in that aero position for so many hours a week. And again, in the swim, so many hours a week, overdeveloping some muscles and therefore taking the spine, which is the base, the root of our posture, into so many uncompromising positions. And you can have people work on you and adjust you and try to manipulate your body back into a place of, let's call it homeostasis, right? But what you really should be doing yourself is learning how to do proper movement or undo movement that hasn't been serving you so that your spine can feel more free and so that you can come from a place of less pain and inflammation and, you know what, have better posture. It's all about posture. So one of the things that I've noticed since I started my business and it escalated to such a big level is that because I wasn't spending so many hours practicing Pilates, because really, who has the time to be doing Pilates 10 hours a week anymore, right? My posture has suffered a lot, and I do get tightness in my neck and tightness in my shoulders, soreness in my quads, maybe soreness in my hips. So we do the best that we can to undo the damage that our life gives us. And that's really what Pilates is. Pilates has taken a broad spectrum over the last decade, and there's lots of different Pilates-based moves that are out there right now. Really what we're talking about when we talk about Pilates is working from the inside out, stabilizing the core and working around the joint level. But there are lots of fun things out there that are not necessarily traditional Pilates that come from a core Pilates concept, no pun intended. And one of the ones that I love is this new method called Legree, which uses similar machines, but it's a little bit more fitness-based rather than traditional-based, where they play loud music, and that's just where I am these days in my exercise routine. But I do have all of my traditional Pilates equipment, my reformer, my Cadillac, my Wunda chair, my Pilates mat, which is a specific kind of mat, and lots of other props and things in my home, and I can practice when I want to. So some of the most amazing things to do for your body are literally stabilize your core and move your body in certain ways. And you'll notice that sometimes it feels like you're carrying these really crazy heavy weights when all you're doing is lifting your arm up in the air, because you're utilizing muscles and maybe stretching them and taking them to a place of flexibility that you might not have been taking them before. So I can't even recommend Pilates or Pilates-based exercises enough. They are wonderful, and I do believe that if we want to stand confident in our world and also have this connection to our body from our mind, Pilates is a great place to start, and you should figure out a way to find it in your area. So, you know, doTERRA essential oils are great in any fitness-based routine, but I want to recommend a couple of oils that you can use in conjunction with your practice. First of all, one of the things that Pilates does is it helps you open up your respiratory system. So when we can lift our collarbones up and take the head of our humerus upper arm bone back and widen the clavicle and bring the pelvis into a certain position and work on bringing the ribs down and in, we can actually enhance the way that we breathe. And a lot of the exercises are intended to literally roll out your spine and get you breathing better. So I would definitely suggest using our Breathe Respiratory Blend, which is an amazing combination of essential oils, including oils like laurel leaf and peppermint and eucalyptus, melaleuca, lemon, cardamom, ravintsara, just to name, well, probably most of them. And you can actually take a couple of drops of Breathe and you can rub it on your respiratory, the area around your respiratory system, so that you feel amazing and you can actually feel the respiratory system enhancing your breathing, enhancing during the practice. Another thing that I love using during your during a Pilates practice is our balance blend, which is our grounding blend. And one of the reasons that we want to have a practice like yoga or Pilates is to get grounded, right? It's to just find our center and move from there. So I love the warm, woody aroma of balance, and it really does provide us with a sense of calm and well-being. Those perfectly combined oils like ho-wood and spruce and frankincense, blue tansy and blue chamomile, along with that fractionate coconut oil, are really beautiful fragrance that enhances tranquility and also relaxation. And then I personally love all of our uplifting oils and blends. And one of the ones that is my favorite is our citrus blend oil. This is an invigorating blend. And again, you can diffuse this in your room, in your Pilates room or in your workout room or in your space, or bring a diffuser to your Pilates studio. We're merging a bunch of the citrus oils here together in this invigorating blend. And all of these refreshing properties from these oils can uplift our mood and at the same time reduce stress. So citrus blend merges grapefruit, lemon, wild orange, mandarin, bergamot, tangerine, and clementine with a little hint of that vanilla absolute that gives us this really beautiful, yummy, delicious. It even smells like an orange creamsicle, if you can remember that from the days of your childhood. It's so yum, 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 yum. All right, I'm going to give you two more. Aroma Touch Massage Blend is just perfect for this kind of practice. It's traditionally called a massage blend, and it combines, again, a bunch of oils that help provide a relaxing and comforting effect. So we have essential oils like cypress and peppermint, which, by the way, peppermint is a great one that you could use on your own. Take a little, I call it a drop of peppermint in your hands or in your nose, a little swig of peppermint by dipping it in your finger and popping it in your mouth, or even drinking a little bit of water with a drop of peppermint. And in the Aroma Touch blend, you also have the marjoram, the sweet marjoram, the basil, the grapefruit, the lavender. And this is part of, as you probably know, the Aroma Touch technique. And it, the oil, the blend as a whole, gives us this profound whole body wellness experience. And then I know that you're waiting for it. I can't leave without mentioning the Deep Blue Soothing Blend, which is an awesome blend, perfect for massaging into your muscles or your joints after a long day or your new intense Pilates workout. So this is so soothing, and you have this combination of wintergreen and camphor, peppermint again, ylang ylang, helichrysum, blue tansy, blue chamomile, and osmanthus, and they work together to soothe your muscles and to cool them. So whether you are spending a lot of time on your cellular device or on your computer, or whether you're in the Pilates studio, I encourage you to try rubbing Deep Blue into your fingers, your wrists, your shoulders, your neck, your hips. Just a few drops of the soothing blend can be a really nice cooling and comforting massage to your body. So I hope this helps, and I encourage you to start or continue your Pilates practice with all of the new oils that you can combine and use during that practice. Thank you.